Hi everybody, welcome to Ubuntu May. So in continuing with the subject I talked about in my last video, which was codependency, I've been thinking a lot about this. I've been watching more videos concerning Black mental health and how it differs from mainstream or white mental health, because we have different things that we face. And also within that category, you have Black women, you have queer people, you have all kinds of things that affect our mental health differently based on how we feel that our positions are in the society that we live in. Now, on my channel, I believe that nothing just exists in a box of itself, and I also believe that nothing also comes just out of the blue, but everything is interwoven together and everything is part of an entire system, ecosystem. Whether it's healthy or not, it's connected to in a lot of ways in order for it to sustain itself, in order for it to keep being the norm. So when we talk about codependency in the last video, there were some of you who not only shared your own upbringing, but also shared, there was somebody who also talked about racism and I think maybe colonialism and how this is related. And of course, I love to talk about colonization here and decolonization. And so those are also subjects I like to talk about when I'm talking about mental health here, Black mental health. Anyway, so if we are to talk about codependency and racism, and especially for today, I wanted to talk about respectability politics. But before I even go all the way there, I wanted to go back to codependency and say that, what does codependency make you as a person? Okay, so as I mentioned in my last video, I'm also recovering codependent. I'm learning year by year as time goes by how much I've grown or how much I still have parts of codependency in me, because you cannot undo a whole childhood in just a few years, but we will make the effort, but we will at least try, right? Anyway, so codependency basically makes you a person who's willing to sustain a relationship that is one-sided mostly. It doesn't benefit both people. It usually doesn't benefit both parties of the relationship. In a codependent relationship, there is the passive person. Like I talked about kids being raised, so the child would be the passive role and the parents will be the dominant role. But it doesn't mean as you grow older that you always take on the passive role. Sometimes, like I said, because you're used to that, it's the only way to be in a relationship, you might take the dominant role and you might request that other people in relationships with you act the way you had to act as a kid. So it's not just that you go on forever, or else we would all just be passive people laying around. It might change as we age, right? But I wanted to talk about the part of it that is like almost holding the peace for peace's sake, not for the true meaning of peace, that there is harmony between people, but rather holding the peace where it's one side. Hesitate saying what's on your mind. You conform to what other people need from you. A lot of people pleasing, because your whole value is based on what people think about you, and your whole value is based on if people like you, if they think you're agreeable, because that's what you're taught to be as a child. You're taught to be agreeable, to be respectable, the sense of respect that is met in a codependent relationship. You are also taught to live up to people's expectations of you, to be, like I said, people pleaser, but also you are very, like, you would pray yourself on being very diligent and following orders, you know, never being a troublemaker, even though sometimes you need to make trouble to do the right thing. But you don't learn that. You learn you just want to be a likable person that conforms to the dominant rules or the dominant structure, because that's what you're taught up to be. And then I wanted to also, and then I started also thinking about respectability politics, which is something that often happens in marginalized groups where they police their own to conform to the mainstream values or mainstream rules or expectations, regardless if they believe in them or not, but just in a way to not cause trouble, right? And the reason I started thinking about that was because then in the web of racism, how does our codependency play out? Obviously, regardless if you're a Black person, whatever country you are, if you experience racism or the aftermaths of colonialism, when we're raised to be naturally submissive, when we're raised to obey, don't ask questions, just fall in line, right? Obviously, that doesn't just end once you leave your house. That doesn't just end once you start your own family or find a partner or find jobs. That doesn't just end once you leave your house and then outside you're just a normal functioning person with clear boundaries. No, that goes out into our everyday lives, the way we find partners, the way we build families of our own, the way we act at work, the jobs we find, the way we act in society. Because when you're taught to not have boundaries, to not stand up for yourself, or to be afraid of standing up for yourself, to be agreeable at the dispense of your own values, or if you have any at that point, because maybe they're not even your own values, to keep the peace regardless if it's only beneficial to one person, right? Now, racism is a system that is clearly beneficial to one group of people. It's not a mutually beneficial system. It's usually something that benefits a few people at the expense of a lot of people. And so, like, let's say in a house of two parents and maybe they have three or four kids, they make all the rules, they run their kids on a codependent relationship. The relationship might benefit them. And also, I'm telling you, in African households especially, because like you have kids that are your servants, basically. not saying that kids shouldn't help around the house, but the way it's done, it's almost in a servant kind of way. You have kids that you get to boss around every day. And I think actually it makes sense, because when you think about it, I think I talked about it at some point, that in a system of racism or abuse, abuse trickles down. So because our black families are obviously built in a system that is oppressive towards us, that is discriminatory towards us. So then I imagine that obviously, let's say parents that go to work and they experience lots of discrimination, if they experience lots of unfairness, lots of things that they have to swallow and put up with and be agreeable about and keep the peace about, then they come back home and they have to let that steam go. Because there's a thing with anger. That's why in my last video when I was talking about positive vibes, I only also talked about the importance of addressing our true emotions. And what codependency does is actually teaches you how to be very good at burying those emotions. Burying them, not like, oh, they're going to disappear and decompose, but they stay there and they fertilize other emotions, right? So then you come back home and you have all this anger, you have all this aggression, because at home you're allowed, you have people who are below you, you know, you go to work or whatever, your school, you experience all this aggression and you're agreeable, da da da, and then when you come home you can take your mask off and actually show your true colors, like the things that your parents would say to you would never dream of saying to anybody else who they thought was above them, even if they were to act more poorly than you ever did as a child, for example, right? So in that sense, then we pass on this aggression towards each other, but we make sure that the people who actually deserve the aggression never get to experience it. Oh, we have the cutest puppies here, and they're now like exploring outside of their little spots. It's quite interesting to see. Oh, you're gonna concentrate. Yeah, so the aggression is constantly pushed around, and not only that, but in the group, the people encourage each other to stay compliant, to stay through respectability politics, to not make a fuss, to not speak too much, or if they get in trouble, they're like, yeah, because you are causing trouble, you should just stay in line. So codependency, then, it's not just a problem that I have personally, but it's a problem that then affects us as people, as a community, as a race, because then we go on to do things that are not beneficial to us as a group, that are beneficial to a few people at the expense of the majority. It doesn't teach you to be your own person, to stand up for what is right, to face confrontation. And it doesn't mean that you are going to be angry. Okay, if you're angry, you're angry. But what I'm saying is that to teach you how to handle conflict constructively, to teach you to be your own person, to teach you to have self-validation and self-esteem enough to know that you do not need to be agreeable with everybody, that it doesn't teach you how to speak up and be heard and feel like your voice matters. Like, even for me having this channel, like, it was a big thing for me because here I am publicizing my opinions about stuff, and it was a big step because I would never have been that kind of person before, because I feel like, who am I? I don't know all of this stuff. I haven't studied all this. So it's always you doubting yourself, doubting your value as a person. But when you slowly try to start to unlearn all these codependent behaviors, the people pleasing, the being nice at all costs, this is also why I say be kind, but don't take any shit, because I strongly believe in that. I naturally am a person who likes to get along with other people. That's my first initial reaction when I meet new people. I want to get along. Not I want to get along, but I I don't cause drama for drama's sake, if that's the case. Like, I like to get along with people. I like to have good relationships with people. But I'm not going to be so desperate to be liked or to be wanted that I'll do anything, you know? And a lot of codependent people, unfortunately, that's one of the things, that they're willing to do anything to be liked or to be loved, because they didn't have that experience growing up, that feeling of unconditional, centered, grounded love. So they'll look for it in anything that they can find it at. And that affects us when we talk about racism, because we are looking for the approval of the same people that oppress us. We are looking for the approval and agreeability to be told that you're good enough, you're smart enough, you're worthy of existence. And we'll look for it anywhere than where we should have had it in the first place, which is from our homes, which is from the people we grew up with, which is from our community. And you can see it also on a community base, as Black people, as African people, how we often value the praise and validation of others more than our own praise. Because from an early age, if we are talking codependency, and I'm not saying that this is every Black person, every Black family, every Black community, I'm just reflecting on this. But yeah, so from an early age, you are taught that your validation does not come from within. It's something that you get every now and then. It's not consistent. So it's like it creates that addictive feeling of, okay, if I do this and I get this reaction, I want to keep getting it, and I'm going to keep doing stuff to make sure that I get the love and validation that I'm craving. And in truth, we all deserve to feel loved, even if it's not from other people, from yourself. We all deserve to feel that we are valuable. We all deserve to feel that we matter, and what we have to share in this world matters just as much as the person breathing next to me. Nobody is born here from a freaking star. Like, we are all going to be decomposed when we die in the sand or in the earth. We're all going to go back to the soil when we die. We all breathe air to exist, unless there are aliens here, which wouldn't surprise me. By the way, I might also make conspiracy theories at some point, because there's a lot of shit we got to talk about, guys. Anyway, so yeah, codependency, respectability politics, and racism, like, those things are connected. Like, all our mental issues that come from the same system that oppresses us and that we do not talk about or heal or address tend to also benefit the system that caused them. I like this quote that say that the person who hurt you cannot be your healer. We cannot expect the same system that have caused us to be in the situations we currently are to also be the solutions for us to find a better way of existing. We have to find that within ourselves. And for me, that is stuff like this, sharing with you guys. And the way that I have done it is obviously trying to educate myself, on my people, trying to educate myself on the things that I did not have growing up and how they've affected me as an adult. I have become a curious person to know why the world is the way it is, why people are plagued the way they are, and how I, as an individual, part of the collective, I'm also influenced by that plague, and how I contribute to it knowingly or unknowingly, and how I can, yeah, do different things to get different results. Cannot keep doing the same things and hope that one day we'll get a different result. We have to be proactively looking for different ways to do things. And for me, one of those things is heal yourself, heal the people around you, or help them heal, or show, not everybody can be healed, because healing is something you have to sign up for yourself. But by healing yourself and informing the people around you who want to know, who also want to heal, it's possible for us to create a different way of existence for ourselves, where we have pride as a people, where we have validation and love for ourselves, where we have understandings for each other and support for each other, and compassion for each other, and hopefully create a dope-ass future for our people and our children and so on. I'm going to add some links in the description box below on Black mental health and also about codependency. If you watch this after I've posted my blog post on Bloom Baby Bloom, which is my personal website, I'll be talking about my journey towards recovery, my current journey towards recovery from codependency, the tools I use, my triggers, and so on. And if you are interested in knowing more about this for your own sake, I'll put it below as well once it's published, so that you could also read that if you are interested in that. Otherwise, guys, please do take care, get informed, get curious, get cured. So I wish you all well, as always. Be kind, but don't take no shit. And I'll see you in my next video. Bye, guys. Ni siku nyingi hatujaongea hizi enzi.
Kia Barua.